Have you guys been noticing that when they report the numbers of COVID on a daily basis, that there's also this like overarching number that seems to be a whole lot bigger? So for example, they might report that there's only 29 active cases in one place, but there's over 300 per 100,000 also identified. So how do we get to those numbers? Well, this is known as incidence versus prevalence. And what we're getting on a daily basis right now with our COVID pandemic is a lesson in epidemiology when it comes to reporting numbers based on incidence and prevalence. So we're going to talk about those two factors in this video, break down those numbers so they make sense to you right after this. Welcome back. My name is Tammy and this is Nurse Minder, and on this channel we do everything nursing. So if you're new here, consider subscribing below so that you get the next video when it's released. Now before we head to the board so I can kind of detail this out for you in pictures, I'm a visual learner, I like to see things. We're going to just first basically define incidence and prevalence. So incidence is the number of new cases per a defined set of population over a determined amount of time. So the new cases, we hear those every night. We had 157 new cases. We had 86 new cases overnight. That is one piece of information we need to identify what the incident rate is. Now, prevalence is really a factor of how many people have it currently within the population overall. So let's go to the board and just kind of look at those two things in more detail. Now, when it comes to incident rates, we're looking at how many new cases per a defined population. And what that means in defined population is that everybody who belongs in this category needs to have the potential to become at risk or to move into a diagnosis of whatever it is you're measuring. So in this lesson, we'll talk about COVID, but this could be tuberculosis. This could be heart attacks. So if you were looking at heart attacks, for example, you would get rid of everybody who's under the age of 18 and maybe even under the age of 30. And then that would reduce the population size because 4-year-olds don't have heart attacks. All right, so in this case, because it's COVID, everybody is at risk. We've had no data that comes out to show that children are not at risk. There's no difference between gender so far. Male and women are affected. There's no ethnicity, immunity, based on where you live and where you were born. So everyone's at risk. So the entire population is in this defined set. So from here, let's just say this person, and this person become infected. We now have 3 new cases in our population size of 10. So in order to create the risk factor, so say all of a sudden we had a mass group of people move into our community, and our community now is 1,000 people, we're going to multiply that by 1,000, and that tells me that I have a potential 300 people that will move from our defined population into our new cases. So there's a risk that we can identify, and then we can plan to implement strategies to manage the risk, just like we did with COVID, by making sure we had enough staff and ICU beds and ventilators. That was part of the planning based on the risk that was assigned to it. And then we can also plan education, prevention, such as our swabbing and vaccinations, to meet the demand. So let's just take these 10 people over here and let's just assume, or let's pretend for example's sake, that they have decided or they've come out with information that says anybody under the age of 10 is immune. We've never seen a case, doesn't matter what we do, they just don't seem to get COVID. So we're going to say that these two people here are under the age of 10, so they no longer count in our population base. They're not part of our defined population anymore. So now I have a base population of only 8 people who are at risk of getting COVID and moving into the diagnosed cases. So we now have 8 as our base population instead of 10. With that, we're going to say 3 people become infected. So 3 out of 8 will become infected. If we multiply again by a population size of 1,000, the incident rate, the risk rate, goes from 300 now to 375. the risk factor has increased because the population size has decreased. All right, so on September 7th, we had 157 new cases in Alberta. So that's that new cases for incidence. What's the total population that's at risk in Alberta? It's 4.428 million people. Now, when we're talking about this big of a number, we like to break it down into per 100,000 people. So when you do the math, 157 divided by 4.428 million times by 100,000 people, you have an incident rate of 3.5 people per every 100,000 in the province of Alberta. But as we know, there are places that have higher incident rates than others. Some have zero cases, some have hundreds of cases. So being selective about the population that you're choosing for the area that you live, understanding how many new cases will tell you what the risk level is to getting that illness or disease. Now let's look at prevalence. Now, prevalence is different in the sense that it's looking at the number of affected people. So this will include new cases, but it will also include the cases that were diagnosed yesterday where the person hasn't recovered, 10 days ago if the person hasn't recovered. And so this number will be higher, and it is over the total population, not just that defined subset. All right, so let's look at COVID numbers and look at prevalence, because this is what we often see in our map online when we Google those numbers. Here we have an example of Vulcan County. This is September 7th here in Alberta. Note that they have a rate of active cases per 100,000, and that is at 313 people. They only have 29 active cases, and the population size is only 9,245. So what do these numbers really tell us? So when we come back and look at prevalence, remember prevalence is the number of people affected, and in that case it was 29 cases. That's how many active cases they currently have right now. So remember, active is new cases plus those who have been diagnosed before. Over the total population, and their population was 9,245. So if we do this math, 29 divided by 9,245 and multiply that by 100,000 to represent the prevalence per 100,000 people, should that many people live in that country, we would see they have 313 per 100,000. This again helps to provide information for planning to make sure that people are accessing the resources that they need. But this doesn't tell the whole story. Remember that this is the number affected, and people can move in and out of this category by recovery or death. And we know that there are people who are dying from COVID, and same thing with this total population. This can change with births and deaths, so that number is fluid as well. So that is our lesson on incidence and prevalence. Now when you're hearing the nightly news, you can go, okay, we have 157 new cases, but that's out of how many? And what does that look like for risk? What is my actual potential risk if I was in a room of 100 people? And of course, prevalence, looking to see where we're at currently with this illness, and that will help you to understand why the planning is in place and why certain measures have been taken to reduce the risk and to navigate the health challenges that people are going to be coming up against. Don't forget to comment below. Let me know what you've learned out about your incidence and prevalence rate where you live. Is it as bad as where I've just shared, or is it better? Let me know below. Until next time, make it a great day. Hey, I know you're probably not ready to get off your phone or go back to work just yet, or maybe even turn the lights off to go to sleep. So why don't you spend a little bit more time here watching another video?